Hi, everybody. I'm joined here with Zulfi Alam. Thank you. Hello. Before we go and talk about the HoloLens display, I hear you have a video to show us. So let's go ahead and go to the video first. That was amazing. So can you tell us about who you are and what you do at Microsoft and what you're all about?
Thank you. My name is Zulfi Alam. I'm the general manager for optics. But before we get to my part of the presentation, I want to know what's up with the outfit.
Well, you know, I thought I'll change things up a bit. Everyone's dressed so nicely and everything. I thought I'll be a bit different. So I'm a giraffe today.
We should have coordinated. But anyways, thank you so much. So what I do want to do is talk a little bit about the display and the display tech that we have developed. When we talk about the display, the first thing that I want to address and talk about is the custom silicon. We are one of the unique companies on this planet that have our own custom silicon that can design things right from scratch. We have our own optics team, we have our own system team, we have our own software team, and we have our own algorithms team. There are not many companies in this planet.
Right, we have a lot of investment in this.
Yes, yeah. Right, but this all under one umbrella.
Right.
So we can innovate at a really fast pace and come up with really novel solutions. So when we wanted to build this second generation display, we're like, the technology just didn't exist, and we had to develop it from ground up. So we developed our own custom silicon. We developed our own MEMS-based display, and I'll get into the reasons why we went on this MEMS direction. But we developed this display. We moved away from LEDs down to lasers, much more light efficient.
So from the first HoloLens one to the second HoloLens.
Correct. Right. The first HoloLens was based on LED-based. We went to lasers.
Lasers.
And then we, instead of using an LCOS or a DLP-type approach, we went to this microelectronic mirrors, and which we call MEMS. And essentially, there's some tiny mirrors that are moving back and forth really fast and essentially rendering the image. And the advantages of this are obvious. When you have a chip, as you think about increasing field of view, the chip just gets bigger and bigger. When you have this MEMS approach, and as we think long term, we can simply change the scan angle of these MEMS and essentially render a bigger display. We'll talk more about that next.
Okay.
But so essentially, we went for this MEMS display. And The advantages are super crisp and super obvious. The first thing is the field of view just dramatically jumped. It jumped by 2x. We started off with 36 degrees. We are up to 51. That's twice the display. Same form factor.
Right.
And or lighter and or smaller. So normally when you make things bigger, you don't say the same or go smaller. So this is a huge, huge accomplishment by the people working on this. And they are the most amazing development team on the planet. The next thing that we did is comfort. Every human is unique. This is a wearable device. And as you go about trying to design a device that doesn't need 10 different SKUs, small, medium, large, male, female, we were able to encompass all that because we designed from the scratch and for these humans. And we said, hey, this device is going to be the best-in-class enterprise device on the planet. So as you saw, these are people on the team, and they had different heads and form factors, and they are all able to wear the same device.
Like, I have a different head than you that have a head, so it's...
and that's the point, right? The whole point is you don't want people to spend $3,500
right,
just customize for one human. You want to be able to pass this device to you and enjoy the same experience.
Right.
And finally is contrast. This device has amazing contrast. Because we're based on lasers, we can switch the lasers off wherever the hologram is not important. So we have these two images side by side. As you can see, and I'll try to put my cursor on this, the hologram ends here, but you can still see this haze. That's what happens when you have an LCOS based system. On the HoloLens 2 system, essentially, the display system effectively switches off.
Right, so when there's nothing to show, it just lasers off, and you can see straight through it.
You can see straight through it.
So if I have a hologram, I can see behind it if there's nothing there, right?
Exactly right. Yeah. And that is a fundamental, it's 2,500 to 1 contrast ratio. That is the best in class. So we're super proud of the work. So that's all I had in terms of talking about what we had developed. Would love if you had any questions.
What I'm actually really curious about this is, maybe you can talk a bit about how is this different than other similar devices, let's say the Magic Leap. Like, how is this display different than the Magic Leap display?
Good question. So I want to be careful how I answer this. There are multiple great companies on this planet, aka Apple, Google, Magic Leap is one of them. They're attempting to go after the same holy grail, which is to build a head-mounted device that's awesome. The approach that we took was fundamentally different, because we said, hey, they're going to make sure this device is comfortable for all users. So we designed the eye box, the active area where we can see, to be much, much larger than anybody else can do. We have eye relief that is much larger than anybody else. And we are the only device that you can actually read text on. So imagine if you're an enterprise worker and you want to read a manual while you're trying to repair something, you can actually read the text. So the reason why we were able to do all those things so effectively is because we have the ability to simulate the production of a photon in the laser, all the way through the light engine, through the waveguide, into your eye box. No one else has the ability to do that.
So how do you do that? How do you know where the user's eyeball is? Like, I mean, when I put the HoloLens on, like, it could be in all kinds of directions, right?
You're right. Like, this is the amazingness of Microsoft algorithms.
Right.
The whole point is you have no references. Your head can be anywhere, and you want to put an image stable in front of you while your head is moving, versus the other way around. So we have these algorithms that are late-stage reprojection, which essentially know, based on head movement, where your head is going to be. And we project the image. We fire the laser off right at the right time to make sure that we start the rendering of the image at the right place.
And even if I have glasses on, or no matter what I have in front of, like in the middle of it, it still works.
That is correct.
Right.
Because the eye relief is so much larger than anybody else, we can accommodate glasses.
But the
no
difference
problem.
Between my eye and the actual screen, like, there's a lot of difference there, right?
No problem. We can accommodate any eye relief eye reliefs that they'll encompass 99.9% of humans, including glasses.
That's great. So let's talk about the field of view. You mentioned it's much like twice the field of view of the HoloLens 1. How did you actually get to twice the size? How was that possible?
So what we did was, instead of going with this LCOS approach where you need it for a larger field of view, you need a larger imager, we went the other way. We went with this MEMS approach. So essentially, by changing scan angle, we are able to produce an image that is as large as the pixel pipeline can support.
Okay.
So the pixel pipeline is designed to support 51 degrees. Our scan angle of our mirrors are able to support that, so we can increase the image size. So which is different from the original approach, which was, hey, this is fixed, 36 degrees.
Right, so this is a whole new technology for the screen. You completely replaced the old technology, and this is a whole new thing.
This is a whole new way.
Why did you decide to go this direction with the display? Like, why did you decide with lasers? I mean, lasers are cool, of course. Other than that.
Size, weight, and power.
Right.
So lasers are cool, and they are also the most efficient mechanism by which we can produce light. So hence, that was the right choice. It has its own art. It has its own set of challenges, but it's the right call. Because of the MEMS approach, as we increase the field of view, the weight doesn't change, so it's also lighter than the original design point. And again, the SRGs are waveguides. They're the best in class. So we are able to maintain our size and our power constraints and yet deliver a much larger field of view.
That's amazing. And then how did you make it so it actually fits multiple people and multiple people can use it? Like, what was the process you went through to test this out on all these different, make sure it works on all these different
good question. We started with a database of a publicly available database of what are the head form factors. And then we built models in-house, hundreds and hundreds of models and thousands of data points where you essentially scan the heads of different humans. And then you come up with a spec, say, hey, what do you expect a human with what the eye relief is going to be? Where is his eye going to be versus where the lens has to be? And what's the maximum we can accommodate? So this is essentially a very tedious exercise of collecting thousands and thousands of head scans and then building a spec that supports all of them.
So I bet you've went to all kinds of Microsoft employees even outside of that and kind of tested everybody. Just, hey, just put this thing on and just don't worry what it is right now.
I wish it was that straightforward, but yes, we did build multiple. We actually built a setup just to measure heads of humans. So
that's amazing. Yeah. And then you talked about high contrast. Can I use this outside? Like if I'm outside or in the sunny day or in the park, what does it work?
So previous devices have been sort of capped at very low number of nits, so 500 nits. This device, yes, you can. I'm not sure if we have actually committed to the number outside the company, but we are designing this device that it can go to extremely high nits, over 1,000, and you should be able to wear this outside environment. Yes.
And then how do you manage to use the lasers to actually display the image two-dimensionally? Like right now, you have one laser, you guys have mirrors. How do the mirrors work together with the laser? And then how does that work?
Right, so essentially you have a fast scanner that is essentially scanning in the horizontal direction. And then you have a slow scanner once you paint the image horizontally, you move it one pixel down, start painting it vertically. So there are two mirrors working in conjunction with each other. One working on the horizontal axis, one working on the vertical axis.
And the resolution of this screen is really large, right? How fast does this actually mirror actually scan through it? If you have to, you have this
54,000 times.
So 54,000 times, you have a laser that just prints it on.
That's the mirror cycle time. It's 54,000 times a second, and each pixel you're firing, the laser is firing for each pixel. So it is a couple of million pixels that we're able to render. So yes, the text readability of this device is amazing. So our internal metric, is essentially 8-point font. So developers should be able to make content that allow them to render content that's 8-point font, which is pretty cool.
That is incredible. Thank you so much for being here with us. I think I learned a lot. I hope everybody else learned a lot.
Thank you so much for having us.
Now, thanks everyone for joining. It's time to check in and see what's happening on the floor. What are you up to out there, Christina?